Hello, my name is Greg Leek, and I'm a product manager at Microsoft on the SQL Server team, and I'm happy you could join us today. I'm also joined here by my colleague, Russell Bowden.
Thank you, Greg. I work for Intergen. We're a Microsoft partner based out of New Zealand, and recently we've been working alongside Microsoft to help provision a data insights immersion experience. We've been looking at multiple modules over this immersion experience in similar sets to this one. And throughout the course of this story, we're going to be looking at how you can collaborate and share information or insight that we've gained throughout running the previous modules.
Great. So let's take a look at a couple of slides that kind of set up the scenario that we're going to look at specifically. So we're actually going to do a couple of pretty cool things here. We're going to take a data model, and we're going to actually publish it out to SharePoint. So this is a data model that we've built up in other modules. And the key point here is that by publishing it to SharePoint, we're going to accomplish two things. First, we're going to make sure that that data is constantly and automatically refreshed. So all of our visualizations, all of the model that we've built up doesn't need to be manually refreshed. And second, by putting it in SharePoint, obviously we're collaborating and sharing it with other users in our organization.
Yep.
Then the other thing that we're going to do in this particular scenario is then use a specific feature of SharePoint to say, hey, we've got all of these great business intelligence visualizations. Wouldn't it be great to embed these directly within PowerPoint presentations so that when we go to our next executive review, we can use these visualizations to essentially tell a story to our executive management about particular trends that are happening in sales, targeted marketing campaigns we might want to do, and justify those with the data visualizations that we've built up.
Absolutely. It becomes a very effective medium for us to convey the same message, but to a completely different audience. If I'm a senior exec or I'm in a board briefing, I don't want somebody to stand up and pull up Excel.
Right.
To see everything through a PowerPoint presentation.
In a more visual fashion.
Absolutely, and this provides an excellent mechanism for being able to do just that.
Okay, well let's take a look at the demonstration so we can see how this looks live within the Immersion experience.
Certainly. So if we jump into Immersion, we're delivering all of the content through a Windows 8 application. So we have a summary of what we're looking to do through this experience as Greg's just outlined for us. We can also view all of the individual click-throughs for the steps and processes that we're actually going to be following in able to achieve this.
So when partners go into this site, this is the actual experience they'll see where they can step through exactly what we're doing and follow these steps with the interactive instructions to step through building out a live environment with exactly what we're showing.
Yep, click for click, it's exactly what we're demonstrating
okay.
here.
Okay, let's get started. I guess the first step is open an Excel workbook.
Yep, all of our base information, currently all of the analysis that we've done is stored in Excel.
Okay, so that's the backing data, the tabular data model, and the visualizations we've built on top of that.
So yes, this one's certainly looking at the visualizations we've created in Excel. As you will have seen in previous modules, we're actually pulling that data in from a combination of our corporate SQL Server analysis services environment, as well as from the external web pages that we've been referencing for both demographic data as well as for Wikipedia information,
okay,
population
census
change.
Data. So it's workbook that we've built up with visualizations through the Immersion experience that we now want to take to the next level by publishing it out to SharePoint.
Absolutely. So I'm just going to go ahead and open that now. And we'll jump to our location.
All right. And we'll take a look at the workbook here live running in Excel. So at this point, this would be considered still really a personal BI workbook.
So it's my own personal visualization.
Okay.
But we do have all of the data stored for us in the structured corporate environment.
In a SQL Server analysis service setup.
Yep. So we know that if I'm the person accessing it or you're the person accessing it, we're still viewing
the same source data.
Yeah, absolutely. So we have here our completed dashboard.
And mm-hmm.
You may have seen us building this out in
the previous
modules.
These include the more interesting visualizations as opposed to just tabular or bar chart information.
Absolutely.
So we'll open those up.
We'll just have a look at this one here when it loads. just to show that it is exactly the same workbook.
Okay.
And it's a complete version. We don't want to load a part version up onto the file share.
And the idea here is that by publishing the SharePoint, we're not only going to be able to share it with other users, but we're actually also going to be able to keep the data sources refreshed constantly on an automated basis. So when I go to that SharePoint site, I know that I'm looking at the visualizations based on the current version of the data.
That's right, because when we're talking server to client, as we have been up until this point, mm-hmm. it's reliant on the person on the client end being able to hit refresh to pull down those latest bits of information. When we're talking server to server, and in this case it's between the SharePoint environment and the SQL Server environment. And
SharePoint does that refresh against the SQL Server data automatically.
Yep, so we don't have to worry about doing that as a manual step. So here are the visualizations that we've created in our previous scenario.
Okay.
And I'm quite simply going to come in to the Save menu, choose Save As. I'm going to Browse for a location. And we've got our SharePoint site loaded up here.
Just in File Explorer, so we're now pointing at the actual SharePoint
yep.
site for our work group.
So we can see that somebody else has already loaded something to our environment.
Right.
So we're going to take a copy of this, and we're going to call it Final Analysis. We want to add a quick title to it, so a cut-down version for people to reference when they're doing their SharePoint document library search.
Okay.
So we'll just call this Customer Analysis. And we're going to choose Save Thumbnail. Now, this creates a nice little thumbnail icon so people can actually visualize what's in the workbook without having to open it when they get inside their Power Pivot gallery. So we're just going to say Save now. Now, as it loads it up to SharePoint, we're being asked what type of gallery do we want to put it in. So we have report builders. So this is along the lines of SQL Server reporting services.
Mm-hmm.
But we're going to choose Power Pivot Gallery, because we've got Power Pivot content inside our workbook.
So we'll just categorize the content appropriately.
Yep. And we can see now at the bottom of the screen, it's just going to take a few seconds as it's loading this content to SharePoint.
And it looks like it's actually done now, so it's all loaded up into SharePoint, into our portal.
Absolutely. So we can now come through and click to the link for our Contoso BI Power Pivot Gallery on SharePoint.
So we'll just go browse to the SharePoint site.
Yep. So this is just taking a couple of seconds to refresh.
Okay. And we're looking at the Contoso retail dashboard, and then what we publish is actually the lower pane of this, which is the final Contoso retail
customer
analysis.
Yeah, so we called ours final. Yep, that's correct.
Now, as a corporate user within the work group, one of the advantages of SharePoint is also that not only are we collaborating and being able to share it across users, but IT is also being able to control user authentication, so only authorized users would be able to access these views and this visualization on the data.
Yep, and there may also be some business insight that you create that you actually want to share with external third parties, so
mm-hmm.
they might be partner organizations.
Okay.
And again, this is a great way for you to do it. You're in complete control of the data, you know it's refreshed, so they're always seeing the latest information, and it can be messaged out to the right people.
Okay.
And we'll touch on that now. So we can see here in the demo, our thumbnails for our workbook are still loading. We
They're
can see
the
hourglasses. But this is what it will look like in the final one.
Okay.
And we can see as I move between sheets here.
It's actually giving you interactive views across every sheet in the workbook?
We get
That's
a
really
preview
cool.
for all the Excel sheets that we've loaded up. So let's jump down to our report.
All right.
It's loaded up. We're just not seeing the icons. And the first thing we want to do is manage our data refresh.
All right.
So we'll just click on the calendar icon up here. Now, we have the ability to go through and set a lot of refresh information.
In terms of the schedule that we're going to refresh the data on.
Yep.
All right.
So, yes, we absolutely want to refresh our data.
Mm-hmm.
We can now come through and set up a schedule of how we want to do it. So the CFO might be particularly interested in marketing spend,
right?
For example. So we can come through and say for every week we want to run the report on the weekend, so we're not impacting business systems.
Right, so in other words, we're running the load against a backing SQL store, but we want to run it on an offload day, like, you know, a weekend day where we're not going to be throttling our database during the actual work week.
Yep, absolutely. So we're minimizing business impact. And if we run it weekly on a Sunday, it means that first thing on a Monday morning, as the CFO comes into the office, he's got the right view. So we're going to leave it set to after business hours.
All right.
And we might also want to notify the CFO that
the refresh has occurred and the new version of the visualizations and reports are available.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So he comes in every Monday morning to an email saying it's there.
Just what everybody needs on Monday morning is more email, right?
Absolutely. But if it makes your life easier and the information is presented to you in a consumable format, I'm all for it.
Okay.
So we're just going to select our data sources. And we're going to choose all data sources. And we can see here that it's actually going out through Data Explorer. Mm-hmm. So this is our Wikipedia page.
Okay, so these are the different data sources that is the backing data to these visualizations. And they're coming from a variety of different data sources.
Yep.
One is internet source data, Wikipedia census data.
Yep. The second one is our Contoso corporate information.
Our corporate sales database.
Yep. The third one is our tabular model.
Okay.
So if anybody adds new tables to the model, this will pick it up as well. Or if anybody adds any information to this workbook. So as the author of this workbook, I might add something extra in, and then we're guaranteed that it gets refreshed as well. So we're just going to say OK here.
Oh. Whoops, we might have to try this one again.
Yep. Let's go back to the site. Let's jump back to our Power Pivot gallery.
All right, so we'll select the...
We'll just go back into our data refresh.
Same workbook.
Enable weekly on a Sunday.
Yep, back to the Sunday schedule.
All data sources. So I'll just go ahead and click OK.
All right, so that looks like it's in the process of publishing.
So that's run away now. We've been able to apply our refresh schedule to our workbook. So we're guaranteed now that all of the information we produce off of this shared workbook
is always
up to date.
Plus, the CFO is getting notified every Monday morning.
Absolutely.
That he's got something new to look at. Okay.
Okay. So the next thing that we want to do is to be able to generate a publishable report. So it's another Power View report. The difference for this one is that it focuses on producing an RDLX file. Now, the real difference between this and a standard Power View is that we can actually embed this file from SharePoint into other applications.
Like PowerPoint. So basically, we're just going to be able to use it as a widget within a PowerPoint presentation, but not just a static widget. We're not embedding an image of the workbook. We're actually embedding a clickable, interactive version of the visualization right within PowerPoint.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. So you can
correct.
Be in presenter view, presenting your slides, and then all of a sudden be able to interact within PowerPoint live in the presentation.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So let's quickly build out a sample Power View here inside our SharePoint environment.
Okay.
Now, despite the fact that we're in SharePoint, this works exactly the same as Power View on your desktop.
All right.
So it's the same interface and the same drag and drop capability. So we've come down to vCustomer, we've expanded it, and we want to grab the state field. And we'll drag and drop that onto this piece of the page here.
All right. So we're just going to build up a simple visualization.
We're just going to build a simple visualization.
All right.
So we're going to convert this into a map.
This is using the Power Map technology that we covered in a previous module.
So it's now saying that we need to send data to be geocoded to the Bing service.
Yep.
So we're just going to click OK.
So the mapping technology for Power Map is based on Bing interactive maps.
Yep. So then we're going to come in and expand VFact visit.
All right, so we're going to get
some... So this is information from our weblogs file.
Visitor information by state, and the visitor information is coming through our click-through data.
Yep.
From our weblogs.
So we want distinct customer.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to drop that into the size box. And then from the customer table again, So we'll jump back up here. We want to take age group, and we're going to drop that into color.
Okay, so we're going to color this by the age group of the visitor of our websites.
Yep.
And see how that essentially uses the power map to show how that varies by state. Is that correct?
Yes, that's exactly right. So customer interaction with our website by age, by state.
Great.
And that's what we have here. So we'll just change the view slightly.
Yeah, you can see how the map is interactive. You can pan around and zoom in and out.
Yep. Okay, so we want to add something else to this. Let's grab some more metrics. So from the VFAQ visit in the field list, we're going to take time spent. So this is how long people have spent viewing our website.
All right. Again, some more weblog data that's been sourced through HD Insight, our big data Hadoop implementation.
Yep. And we're going to drop that there. We're going to turn this one into a pie chart. So we can just click the drop down and tag the pie chart here.
All right.
And then from the VFAQ visit table again, we're going to take the product category or searched product category. And we're going to add that into color.
All right. So we'll slice it up by product category. Yep.
Now, the minute it looks a little bit peculiar because there's a lot of information in the web blogs that relates to the page persons come from.
All right.
As they enter our site and the page they go to as they leave our site. Now, we're not interested in categorizing those, so they all come out as blanks, and we'll sort that out at the end.
Okay.
Okay, so we'll just resize that so it fits nicely in this space here.
What's our next step then?
So the next step now is to go through and generate some information around the amount of time people have spent on each individual page.
All right.
So we're going to come back to our VFAQ visit table, and we're going to get our distinct customer list, distinct customer click, and drop it into a blank space again.
All right, so this is the click stream data from the weblogs that we're adding now to a third visualization.
Yep. We're going to turn this into a column chart. And then obviously one single block's not much good for us.
No, that's not a very interesting bar chart yet.
No,
how do we fix that?
We're going to take the products viewed. So here's our search product category or our products viewed.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to drop that along the x-axis.
Okay, so now we've broken that data out across the different product categories.
Yep, and as you can see, we still have to clean up. Got the blank issue.
Yep, same as with the pie chart.
Yep. And then the last thing that we want to do is to add some slices to our page so that we can start to dissect and filter and slice and dice our data.
Okay.
So we're just going to come back up here, and we're going to jump into the V customer table. We're going to grab state.
Mm-hmm.
Now, instead of chart this time, we simply want to come up to the top and click slicer.
Okay. And a slicer, I take it, makes it selectable.
Yeah, it allows us to filter by any one of the states in the data tables for us. We probably want to do the same by age group because we've looked at analyzing our data by age.
So we'll add another slicer here.
So we need to find age group in our list. And we want to grab age group.
Mm-hmm.
Drop that one on here. And again, we can just turn that into another slicer.
Right.
And then if we happen to be interested in gender, we'll also do the same thing for there. So we'll just jump into gender.
Okay. So all of these then become selectable fields, so we can just slice into various different views of the data that we might be interested in.
Yep.
By gender across state, by gender across age group.
Yep, absolutely right.
Okay.
And because we've got iconography stored in our database for gender,
mm-hmm.
we can actually pull in the nice looking graphic
okay.
for gender rather than having a simple click box like we've got in the other ones. So this is a reasonably quick layout, but it gets across the idea, and we've covered building the power views.
You built a power view dashboard
previously
on top of real live data.
So the only thing that we've got left to do now is to clean up the blank elements relating to those pages that we're not interested in from our web blocks.
Okay, so we've got to filter out some data.
Yep. So we're just going to come through. We're going to drop age group into our filters zone.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to select everything but the blanks.
All
and
right.
we can minimize this one. And then we want to get gender. And we'll grab gender and drop that in here.
Bring it into the filter view as well.
And again, we want everything but the blanks.
Okay.
We'll minimize that one. And then the last one we want is the product category.
Is this the most important one?
Yep. So we'll go down through the
because this is the one that is going to say, unless we are in a product category on our website, don't bother showing us the data. So if we'll watch this, the pie chart and the bar chart on the left should update very nicely.